May the grace and peace of God be with you.
And also with you.
As we begin our Advent pilgrimage, looking forward to the celebration of the birth of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, let us in prayer and praise, thanksgiving and song, give voice to the hope set forth in the Scriptures that Christ's reign of love and light will indeed come among us. Let us offer ourselves anew as witnesses to the advent of Christ's glory, seeking to bring Christ's light and love to those who sit in darkness.
Come, O long-expected Jesus, come.
Cries in the wilderness. Lift up all the deep valleys. The glory of the Lord shall be revealed. Heaven and earth, may the desert blossom like a rose, and may we, passing through what you have made good, guide each other to your holy mountain, where wolf and lamb can lie down together in peace, for we look to you in hope. Of the nations, may we not put you to the test in our arrogance, but find wisdom, restraint, and courage to beat our swords into plowshares, and no longer to study the ways of war, for we look to John on the banks of the Jordan, immerse us into a baptism of repentance, so that we may rise from water, reaching out our hands to people of all faiths who long for your goodness, for we look to and strengthen your church so that we may be stewards of your abundance and joyful heralds of the banquet to which all are invited, for we look to troubled, and lighten the burden of the poor, so that what we proclaim becomes what we spend ourselves to accomplish, for we look to establish justice in our cities and communities, and to honor the covenant into which we have entered, so that all homes may be lively and joyful, and all children may flourish. For we look to you in hope. Head of the household, what you have entrusted to us, our homes, families, friends, and possessions, be ready always for your arrival, and keep us alert to the signs of your presence, for we look to you. Draw us beyond selfish desire and fear, so that we may give ourselves fully to you. Strengthen our weakness and enfold us at last in your peace. And may what is done in us be according to your will, for we look to you in hope. Bethlehem, make us your children. Simplify and soften our hearts, so that we may enter the realm of God with gratitude and joy, for we look to you. God, eternal light, come among us. Enter our darkness and guide us in those paths of justice and peace that fulfill your purposes for us. Lift us up to rejoice forever in the life of the Holy Trinity, for we look to you in hope. And praise you with the Father and the Spirit, one God from before time and through all eternity.
Almighty God, give us grace to cast away the works of darkness and put on the armor of light. Now in the time of this mortal life, in which your Son, Jesus Christ, came to visit us in great humility, that in the last day, when he shall come again in his glorious majesty to judge both the living and the dead, we may rise to the life immortal. Through him who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Amen.
A reading from the prophet Isaiah. Oh, that you would tear open the heavens and come down, so that the mountains would quake at your presence, as when fire kindles brushwood and the fire causes water to boil, to make your name known to your adversaries, so that the nations might tremble at your presence. When you did awesome deeds that we did not expect, you came down. The mountains quaked at your presence. From ages past, no one has heard, no ear has perceived, no eye has seen any God besides you, who works for those who wait for him. You meet those who gladly do right, those who remember your ways. But you were angry, and we sinned. Because you hid yourself, we transgressed. We have all become like one who is unclean, and all our righteous deeds are like a filthy cloth. We all fade like a leaf, and our iniquities, like the wind, take us away. There is no one who calls on your name or attempts to take hold of you, for you have hidden your face from us and have delivered us into the hand of our iniquity. Yet, O Lord, you are our Father. We are the clay, and you are our potter. We are all the work of your hand. Do not be exceedingly angry, O Lord, and do not remember iniquity forever. Now consider, we are all your people. The word of the Lord.
And so will we. Reading from the first letter of Paul to the Corinthians. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. I give thanks to my God always for you because of the grace of God that has been given you in Christ Jesus. For in every way, you have been enriched in him, in speech and knowledge of every kind, just as the testimony of Christ has been strengthened among you, so that you are not lacking in any spiritual gift as you wait for the revealing of our Lord Jesus Christ. He will also strengthen you to the end, so that you may be blameless on the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is faithful. By him you were called into the fellowship of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. The word of the Lord.
Thank you. gospel of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, according to Mark. Jesus said, "But in those days, after that suffering, the sun will be darkened, and the moon will not give its light, and the stars will be falling from heaven, and the powers in the heavens will be shaken. Then they will see the Son of Man coming in clouds with great power and glory. Then he will send out the angels and gather his elect from the four winds, from the ends of the earth to the ends of heaven. From the fig tree, learn its lesson. As soon as its branch becomes tender and puts forth its leaves, you know that summer is near. So also, when you see these things taking place, you know that he is near, at the very gates. Truly, I tell you, this generation will not pass away until all things have taken place. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away. But about that day or hour, no one knows, neither the angels in heaven, nor the Son, but only the Father. Beware, keep alert, for you do not know when the time will come. It is like a man going on a journey. When he leaves home and puts his servants in charge, each with his work, and commands the doorkeeper to be on the watch. Therefore, keep awake, for you do not know when the master of the house will come, in the evening, or at midnight, or at cockcrow, or at dawn, or else he may find you asleep when he comes suddenly. And what I say to you, I say to all, keep awake." The Gospel of Christ.
Send your Spirit, God, to open our hearts and our minds to your word and strengthen us to live according to your will, in Jesus' name. Even though a largely peaceful Thanksgiving intervened, the recent weeks have been hard for anyone who follows current events. In the midst of all the bad news, I found solace in a fake front page of the New York Times, created by someone with the questionable name of Joe Velks, circulating among my friends on Facebook. Like all good satire, it's really funny, it's really rude, and it's somewhat painful to read. Under a banner proclaiming just how awful everything is, the main headlines, which are hilarious, but I'm sorry to say, unrepeatable in this pulpit, the main headlines mocked the Ferguson grand jury verdict and the Bill Cosby situation. But some of the lesser headlines were almost as good. Study: pizza causes cancer. Obama found crying alone in bathroom stall. And my favorite, weather alert, entire sky to catch fire. For some of us who have lived through the past several weeks, everything does seem at times simply awful. There are days when I too feel like crying alone in a bathroom stall. What is this world coming to? Today is the first Sunday of Advent, the first of four Sundays leading to Christmas. Advent only looks toward Christmas itself at the very end of the season. Here, at the beginning of Advent, our focus is paradoxically on the last things. So here today, the Advent season speaks to our apocalyptic dreads. Whenever we sense that the world is ending, it is good to recall that we are not the first generation in history to feel this way. In today's gospel, Jesus depicts an apocalyptic moment: the sun darkened, the moon dimming, stars falling from heaven. The people to whom Jesus speaks would soon feel, with the impending destruction of the Jerusalem temple, that their world would be ending. Cataclysmic change rarely feels good when you're standing in it. But when you've come used to and invested in the way things are, change can indeed feel like the end of the world. In the last month, we have witnessed a string of events that feel apocalyptic. The spread of the Ebola virus, the continued beheadings by ISIS, the Ferguson grand jury's failure to indict a police officer in the shooting death of a young black man, and then the outrage which resulted from that decision. Then there was the dismissal just yesterday of the charges against former Egyptian President Mubarak for the deaths of hundreds of nonviolent Arab Spring protesters. And then, after that yesterday, yet another shooting spree, this time in Austin, Texas. Both abroad and at home, it seems that an established order is ending, bringing with it nothing but bad news. How are we to make sense of all this change? One way to begin making sense of it would be to think back to Jesus and his contemporaries. The world that they inhabited was changing rapidly too. The Roman Empire, which was seemingly at its height under Emperor Augustus, that empire was beginning its slow slide into ruin and decay in the time of Jesus. In a few decades, the Jewish nation state, organized around the king and the temple, that state would be totally destroyed and the people dispersed by that same empire in its desperate, flailing attempts to exert control. Jesus' followers would soon experience the arrest and trial and crucifixion of their leader. Everything is awful indeed. When Jesus tells his companions in today's gospel, "This generation will not pass away until all these things have taken place," he is not predicting the end of the world. He is predicting the end of their world. The order that they have lived with and grown used to, as unjust and as oppressive as it might be, is on its way out. A new order is going to replace it. And it's into that new reality that his followers will go when they gather and go forth after Jesus' resurrection. Even though the old world was marked by suffering and oppression, it was still their world, the reality that they had come to know and accept. A new world was on its way, but what would it look like, and how could they prepare? The only way they could prepare, says Jesus, was by watching and waiting to see what God might be up to. He says, "Beware, keep alert, for you do not know when the time will come." And then he says, "And what I say to you, I say to all, keep awake." Faced with historical events beyond their control, Jesus' friends are counseled to watch and wait for signs of how they are to read and how they are to adjust to the changes that are coming their way. Now, watching and waiting were just as hard then as they are today. What do you mean, watch and wait? Can't we at least do something? We want to be doers, and yet Jesus is telling us to be watchers. How can we live with all this dread and all this anxiety if all we're going to do is sit here and watch and wait? Last week, I came across a quotation from the great Dietrich Bonhoeffer, the German theologian and resistance leader who was imprisoned by the Nazis and then executed by them toward the end of World War II. Reflecting on the season of Advent and writing from his prison cell, Bonhoeffer says this. He says, "By the way, a prison cell like this is a good analogy for Advent. One waits, hopes, does this or that, ultimately negligible things. The door is locked and can only be opened from the outside. We wait and we hope and we watch for the door of our prison cell to be opened from the outside." Bonhoeffer was a lifelong activist. He risked his life to resist oppression. And yet even such a doer as Dietrich Bonhoeffer realized that there were some forces and some trends that he was powerless to control. All he could do in his seemingly endless prison cell advent was watch and wait, keeping awake for signs of God's hopeful and liberating activity. The world was not ending in the first century. Their world was ending. The world wasn't ending even in the Nazi prison camp. Their world was ending. The world isn't ending now, but our world is ending. Even as they desperately try to exert themselves, certain kinds of violence and certain kinds of privilege are coming to an end. Whether they like it or not, ISIS represents a kind of intolerance and brutality that the world always rejects and will reject again. Whether we like it or not, the privilege that white people, straight people, and men have always counted on is also passing away. The world is not ending, but our world is. What will come to replace it? Will it be better than the world we know now? To find out the answer, we can only watch and we can only wait. But let's remember, though, that watching and waiting are not passive verbs. Jesus tells us to keep awake. Though we hope for this new world as an act of God, we can begin even now to live as if that world were our present reality. Jesus dealt with the oppression and injustice of his day by gathering a community in which life could be lived even now as God intended that it be. You and I can keep awake for God's new world today by living life on God's terms right now. We can renounce violence and hatred now. We can give up our unearned privilege now. We can empathize and make common cause with those who are marginalized and oppressed and degraded by the structures of a world on its way out the door, and we can do that now. Our waiting can be active, not passive. We can make common cause with others and strive with them to realize God's reign of love and justice and peace now. On this first Sunday of Advent, we begin our shared four-week vigil, watching, in Dietrich Bonhoeffer's words, for the prison door of the present moment to be open from the outside. Christmas is coming, but let us not get ahead of ourselves. We live for now in an Advent world. The old world is ending, the new one dawns. We await the coming of one who will set us free, not to shore up the old reality, but to inhabit the new. Our world may be ending, but as followers of Jesus, we hope and we wait for the new one that will replace it, a world more just, more loving, more compassionate. This new world dawns on us even now. There are signs of it everywhere. In the words of today's collect, let us cast away the works of darkness and put on the armor of light. Let us reach out to each other and all creation to help God bring this new world to birth. Let us remember the words of Jesus. And what I say to you, I say to all, keep awake. Amen.
We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father, who with the Father and the Son is worshiped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. In the tender mercy of our God, the day spring from on high shall break upon us to give light to those who dwell in darkness and in the shadow of death, and to guide our feet into the way of peace. The peace of Christ be always with you.
And also with you.
Good morning and welcome to Washington National Cathedral. I'm Gary Hall, the Dean, and on behalf of Bishop Marianne Buddy, the Bishop of Washington, and our chapter, and everyone who works and volunteers and serves this place, it is my great pleasure to welcome you this morning to the first Sunday of Advent at Washington National Cathedral. Whoever you are and wherever you find yourself on the journey of faith, you are welcome at God's table to receive the bread and wine of communion. The ushers will direct you to the communion stations around the building. If you would rather receive a blessing than take communion, please let us know that by folding your arms across your chest, and we'll know that that's your preference. After you've come to the communion stations, you're invited to go to War Memorial Chapel on the south side of the building, and there our healing ministers are gathered, and they will give you the laying on of hands for healing and pray with you for your needs and concerns, those of those who are on your hearts, and the needs and pains of our world. And then after church this morning. We have coffee over in the West End. A few announcements that I want to make. First of all, this morning we are finally come to a place in the Episcopal Church and the United Methodist Church where we have a new agreement that allows us more fully to recognize and celebrate each other's ministries in all their fullness. And so it is a great joy to me and to those of us that serve and worship here that our presider this morning, after several years on our staff, is the Reverend Canon Gina Campbell. So, Gina, thank you for your bureaucratic patience. This is a great day for all of us and for our two churches. Secondly, there's some things going on in our congregation life. We have the Advent Giving Tree every Advent, and that is backed by the coffee hour. So pick up a tag to provide a gift of a toy or a book or a gift card for an area child, and you can also bring unwrapped gifts, and there is information about that. Today at the coffee hour, I ask that you please visit the congregation table following the service to learn about all of the work that's been going on with our Gun Violence Prevention Task Force. We have been at this work now for almost 2 years, and there have been a wonderful, dedicated, active group of Cathedral volunteers who have been doing work with folks outside of us to help prevent gun violence in America, and some of their stuff is on display, and you're invited to join and be part of that ministry as well. And finally, today at 4 o'clock, we have our annual Advent lessons and carols back here in this building, and that's always a beautiful and moving service, so we ask you to consider coming back for that. God has been so generous to us in so many ways, and we respond now to God's generosity by giving to support the mission and ministry that God does through the church and through this cathedral. So let us with gladness present the offerings and the oblations of our life and our labor to God.
be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Almighty God, Creator of heaven and earth. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and spoke to us through your prophets, who looked for the day when justice shall roll down like mountains and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream, when nations shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war anymore. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and sing their unending hymn. And blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ, whom you sent in the fullness of time to be a light to the nations. You scatter the proud in the imagination of their hearts and have mercy on those who fear you from generation to generation. You put down the mighty from their thrones and exalt those of low degree. You fill the hungry with good things, and the rich you send empty away. Your own Son came among us as a servant to be Emmanuel, your presence with us. He humbled himself in obedience to your will and freely accepted death on a cross. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, the Lord Jesus took bread. He broke the bread, gave thanks to you, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this for remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup. Again, he gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink this, all of you, for this is the cup of the new covenant in my blood, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us, as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ has risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we might be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with your Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. Amen. As we join our prayers with those of the Church Universal, so we say each in our own language the prayer that Jesus has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Jesus, wisdom and mighty Lord, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us.
Have mercy on us.
Jesus, true branch of Jesse's tree, take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us.
Have mercy on us.
Desire of nations, our Emmanuel, you take away the sins of the world.
The gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and receive them into your heart with that faith in thanksgiving. Amen. Let us pray. O Lord our God, make us watchful and keep us faithful as we await the coming of your Son, our Lord, that when he shall appear, he may not find us sleeping in sin, but active in his service and joyful in his praise. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. May the God of peace make you perfect and holy and keep you safe and blameless in spirit, soul, and body for the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. And the blessing of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you always. Amen. Amen.
As we await our coming Savior, go in peace to love and serve the Lord.